Goedemorgen, graad 12. Good morning, grade 12. Hoe gaan dit met jullie vandaag? Ek gaan aangaan met ons kort verhaal vandaag. Dit is wat ons basis hierdie hele week gaan doen. Ek gaan proberen dat ons daarom net die hele kort verhaal klaar lees. So I'm going on with our short story today, and that's what we'll be doing the whole week. And I want to make sure that this week we try to finish just the reading of this, as this is one of your prescribed short stories for your final exam. Okay. So let's have a look where we are today. So as you will remember, in our previous two sessions, we were introduced to Len and Robbie. Len was Robbie's manager, and Len had recently fallen on hard times, and Robbie was a young, famous singer who was supposed to be Len's ticket to success. And then Len was sitting in front of his computer working in the middle of the night when Robbie gave him a call about a woman who had died in his hotel room. And then we saw that Len was on his way to go and help Robbie, and he told us the story of how they met and the first night that he heard Robbie singing. So this is where we are now. Len has just arrived at the hotel and now he is speaking to Robbie. Okay, let's go. Ek hou hom vas. Klop hom geruststellend op die skouer. Robbie, ek denk nie ons moet hier in die gang. O, skies Len. En hy loop die kamer in. Ek maak die deur achter ons toe. Wat gaan ons doen, Len? Ek laat hom sit. Ek kry sy keteltjie aan die gang. Ek wil sterk soet tee in hom kry en koffie vir my. Terwyl ek besig is, sê ek vir hom hy hoef nie te bekommer nie. My taak, my verantwoordelikheid, is om sy probleme op te los. Om op te ruim as daar ongelukke is. En dit is al wat hierdie was. Een ongeluk. Hy sit, verwese, kop omlaag, knikkend. Ek vraag hom weer, weet enig iemand dat sy by hom was gisteraand? Ek glo nie, Len. Ek weet nie. Okay, let's have a look at the English translation. I hold him, clapping comfortingly on the shoulder. Robbie, I don't think we should do this in the corridor. Oh, sorry, Len. And he walks into the room. I close the door behind us. What are we going to do, Len? I let him sit. I get the little kettle going. I want to get some strong, sweet tea in him and coffee for me. While I'm busy, I tell him he doesn't have to worry. My job, my responsibility, is to solve his problems. To clean up where there are accidents. And that was all this was, an accident. He sits bewildered, head low, nodding. I ask him again, does anyone know she was with him last night? I don't think so, Len. I don't know. All right, let's continue. Het sy met die motor gekom? Ek dink so, haar sleutels is op die kassie. En hy beduie in die richting waar ek vermoed die ander kamer is. Het jy haar gebel? Nee, glad nie. Ek hou die beker teen hom uit en vraag hom vir die sleutel en die kamernommer. Ek sê hy moet doen wat hy elke oggend op toer doen. Hy moet onder geen omstandighede anders optree of met enige iemand oor die voorval praat nie. En hy moet ophou bekommer. Ek sal sorg. Vir 'n oomblik lyk dit of hy in trane gaan uitbars. Dankie, Len. Dan loop ek uit om met die opruimingswerk te gaan begin. Okay, so let's have a look at the English translation of that. Did she come with a car? I think so. Her keys are on the drawer. And he gestures in the direction where I suspect the other room is. Did you call her? No, not at all. Guys, why is this important that he didn't call her? Okay, so I want you to think of this all in the context of evidence, and there must be nothing that ties Robbie to this girl. I hold the mug of tea out to him and ask him for the keys. Sorry for the typo and the room number. I say he must do what he does every morning on tour. Under no circumstances must he act differently or talk to anyone about the incident. And he must stop worrying. I will take care of it. For a moment, it looks like he's going to burst into tears. Thank you, Len. And then I walk out to go and start with the cleaning work. Okay, so from this, you guys should by now see that Len is a very pragmatic character. Hy's baie pragmaties. Hy is die soort ou wat 'n plan maak. As hy sien daar's moeilikheid, dan maak hy 'n plan en hy begin. So that's basically the kind of manager that you want if you're going to have dead people in your hotel room. Okay, let's go. 7:00 in die oggend. Die hotelgang is genadiglik stil. Ek druk die kaartsleutel in die deur, maak vinnig oop en gaan in. Maak dit versigtig agter my toe. Die gordyne is dig. Die kamer byna donker. Ek trek my asem diep in. Ek onderdruk vrese en weersin. Ek knip die lig aan. Eers dan kyk ek na haar. Onder die spanning en die dreigende paniek ontdek ek 'n sekere makaber en 'n skierigheid. Dit is 'n eerste vir my, hierdie intimiteit met die dood. 7:00 in the morning. The hotel corridor is mercifully quiet. I push the key card in the door, open it quickly and go in, close it carefully behind me. The curtains are thick, the room is almost dark. I take a deep breath. I suppress fears and aversion. I switch the light on. Only then do I look at her. Underneath the tension and the threatening panic, I discover a certain macabre curiosity. It is a first for me, this intimacy with death. Sy lê skuins oor die bed op haar rug, elke arm gemaklik uitgestrek, haar oë toe asof sy rus, sodat ek in die oomblik 'n vreemde geluid maak, 'n wolk van verligting en skok. Robbie de Vier het 'n fout gemaak. Sy slaap net. Ek sal haar wakker maak. Alles gaan reg wees. She lies her agony over the bed, on her back, each arm stretched out comfortably, her eyes closed, as if she is resting, so that in the moment I make a strange sound, a bellowing of relief and shock. Robbie de Vier made a mistake. She is just sleeping. I'll wake her up and everything will be fine. Maar dan besef ek stadig aan sy lette stil. Daar is geen deining van haar bors nie. Die hoek van die slanke bene is onnatuurlik. Haar gelaat doodsbleek. Ek weet nie hoe lank ek staar nie. Na die versteerde linne op die bed. Die naakte vrou met die kort swart hare. Die elegante nek en die perfekte enkels. What a strange thing to describe here, her perfect ankles. Na die handsakkie met die silwer kettingskouerband op die bedkassie neergesit. Die motorsleutels daarnaas. Na die denimbroek en die wit blouse versigtig op die stoel gevou, die sewels reg op teen mekaar en die delikate onderklere roekeloos oor die vloer gestrooi. So het dit gebeur gisteraand. Van ongemaklike beheerste vreemdelinge tot haastige welisgedrewe minnaars. Die vertrek vertel 'n storie. Dit is die afloop van 1000 musiekkonserte, die oorbekende verhaal van groepies en hotelkamers. Dit is deel van die bedryf se DNA. Let's have a look at the translation. Kom ons kyk gou. But then I realize slowly she is lying too still. Sorry for the typo again. There is no movement of her chest. The angle of the slim legs is unnatural. Her face is deathly pale. I don't know how long I stare at the disturbed linen on the bed, the naked woman with short black hair, the elegant neck and perfect ankles, at the little handbag with the silver chain shoulder strap, on the bedside table, the car keys next to it, at the jeans and the white blouse carefully folded on the chair, the boots upright next to each other, and the delicate underwear carelessly thrown on the floor. This is how it happened last night, from uncomfortable, controlled strangers to rushed, lust-driven lovers. The room tells a story. It is the conclusion of 1,000 concerts, the over-familiar tale of groupies and hotel rooms. It is part of the industry's DNA. Now guys, I hope you understand what he means by this. He means that it's not uncommon for fans or groupies to sleep with their idols, and that this is how many concerts end, in fact. Okay, and that it's often part of the industry's makeup. Haar oor, Len, haar oor. Ek dink dit was 'n hartaanval. Sy lê net hier. Okay, so hierso dink Len terug aan Robbie se woorde. Robbie se woorde laas nag, vol angs en verstomming. Ek kom tot verhaal. Ek kry die Do Not Disturb traktaat op die deurknop. Ek maak net wyd genoeg oop om 'n hand na buite te strek en dit daar te hang. Dan grendel ek en draai om. Daar is baie werk om te doen. Her eyes, Len, her eyes. I think it was a heart attack. She's just lying here. Robbie's words last night, full of angst and surprise. I come to my senses. I get the do not disturb sign on the doorknob. I open up just wide enough to reach a hand outside and hang it there. Then I lock up and turn around. There is a lot of work to do. Ek kry 'n kombers in die hangkas en bedek haar. Nie uit pietyd nie, maar om my ongemak te verlig. Haar selfoon is in haar handsak. Daar is geen verbeerde oproepe nie. Sy het sedert gistermiddag skuins voor 6 vir niemand geskakel nie. En daar is geen rekord dat Robbie haar gebel het nie. Verligting. I get a blanket from the closet and cover her. Not out of piety. So guys, this means not out of sense of being proper, but to relieve my own discomfort. The cell phone is in her handbag. There are no missed calls. She has since yesterday afternoon, just before 6, not phoned anyone. And there is no record that Robbie called her. Relief. Okay, so now he's relieved because there's no proof. Hy is verlig omdat daar geen bewyse teen Robbie is nie. In die langswaard leerbeursie, 'n bestuurslisensie, Tasha Ann Harrington, 29 jaar oud. Op die ID-foto lyk sy vaagweg geamuseerd na die kamera, asof sy 'n natuurlike speelsheid moet onderdruk vir die amptelike oomblik. Sy lyk na iemand van wie ek kon hou. The long black wallet, driver's license, Tasha Ann Harrington, 29 years old. On the ID photo, she looks vaguely amused at the camera, as if she had to suppress a natural playfulness for this official moment. She looks like someone I could have liked. A din gerfie versette kaartjies in 'n vakkie van die beursie. 'N sferige, veelkleurige vlam van 'n S en 'n D. Sasha ontwerp, logos, publikasies, webwerwe, met telefoonnommers en 'n adres in Westdean. Ek wonder met eens oor die storie traject wat haar tot hier gebring het. Grafiese ontwerper in Bloemfontein. Waarom was sy mooi en amper 30 nog loslopend? En soekend na haar aanse sinnelose lyflike plesier met 'n amper seun 'n dekade jonger. A small bundle of business cards in a pocket of the wallet. A fancy multicolored flame of an S and a D. Sasha design, logos, publications, websites, with telephone numbers and an address in Westdean. I wonder at once about the storyline that brought her to here. A graphic designer in Bloemfontein. So guys, dit lyk vir my so asof Dion Meyer dink ons mag nie grafiese ontwerpers in Bloemfontein hê nie. Maar gewoonlik, as jy daar dink, baie grafiese ontwerpers eindig in Kaapstad of Johannesburg op waar die meeste werk is. So it's a little bit strange for the narrator to find this graphic designer here in Bloemfontein because most of them do end up in Cape Town or Joburg where there is a lot of work for them. And now he continues with his questioning of this whole situation. Why was she, beautiful and almost 30, still single and searching for an evening of meaningless bodily pleasure with an almost boy a decade younger? So dit maak nie heeltemal sin vir Lenny. Kom ons gaan aan. En watter fisiologiese defek het in haar binneste gesluimer, gewag vir die oomblik van passie, wanneer die bloed bruis en die hart onstuimig klop om haar te versaak? Aan die bossie sleutels is daar een vir 'n Toyota, met afstandsbeheer, knoppies, versluit en alarmaktivering. Dit is my eerste taak, om van die motor ontslae te raak. Ek trek die 2 geel skottelgoed handskoene uit my sak, al wat ek laas nag in my koorsagtige voorbereiding in my meentuis kon kry. Trek dit aan en tel die sleutels op. And which physiological defect had slept inside her? So he's wondering now, guys, what was wrong with her that she could have had a heart attack? Waited for the moment of passion when the blood rushed and the heart beat wildly to abandon her. On the bunch of keys, there is one for a Toyota with remote buttons for locking and alarm activation. This is my first task. So you can see weer. Len is baie pragmaties. Hy dink nou, okay, dit is my eerste taak. Ek moet ontslaa raak van die kar. To get rid of the car, I pull the 2 yellow dishwashing gloves from my pocket. Okay, ek het 'n prentjie vir julle daar gesit, dat julle net kan sien hoe dit lyk. All I could find in my townhouse last night during my feverish preparations, I put them on and pick up the keys. Alright, let's see what Len does next. Dit is 'n RAV 4 wat in die parkeerterrein reageer met 'n verbaasde piep en ligte wat 2 keer flits. 'N swart 2-liter GX outomaties. Enkele ander mense in die parkeerarea. Angstigheid laat my sweet. Hier is die eerste groot risiko, oor wat my sien as ek in die motor klip, of wat my sal opmerk as ek daarin ry. Een kennis of vriend van Sasha Ann Harrington, wat sal wonder wat een vreemde man in haar voertuig maak, oor wat sal onthou, wat kan getuig. It was a rare fall that reacted in the parking lot, with a surprised peep and lights that flashed twice. A black 2-liter GX automatic. Few other people in the parking lot. Anxiousness makes me sweat. Here is the first big risk. Eyes that see me as I climb into the car, or that will notice me when I drive in it. An acquaintance or a friend of Sasha Ann Harrington, who will wonder what this strange man is doing in her car. Eyes that will remember, that can testify. So jy sal sien Len dink heeltyd, wat kan verkeerd gaan, wat kan moontlik maak dat iemand teen my getuig, wat kan bewyse wees. So this whole time he's trying to think, what can go wrong, who can testify against me, what can be seen as proof. Ek stap doelgenig na die raaf toe, bid dat niemand die helder geel handskoene sal opmerk nie. Klim in, sit dit aan. Musiek wat uit die luidsprekers bilder, Robbie se CD, sodat ek ruk van die skrik, en die afsitknopie 2 keer misdruk voor ek dit stil kry. I walk purposefully to the RAV. Pray that no one will notice the bright yellow gloves. Climb in. Start it. Music that blares from the speakers. Robbie CD. So that I jerk from the fright and miss the off button twice before I manage to silence it. Okay, so ek het vir julle hierso net 'n foto van 'n RAV 4 gesit, dat julle net kan sien hoe lyk die kar. So jylle kan sien, dit is nou nie die fancyste kar wat mens kry nie, maar dit is die karretjie waarin hy nou gaan ry. Dit is Sasha se kar. Seker hulle kyk na my, besef my hande bewe. Ek kry die trirad ry, bewus van die subtiele vroue reuk, haar parfum wat hier in die binnenruim talm. Oggendspitsverkeer, dit is 4-stadige kilometer van die hotel na die Loglaugen winkelcentrum, Bloemfontein se as strand benaamde waterfront. Ek hou my hande onder die stuurwiel om die handskoene te versteek. Ek kyk strak voor my. Ek voel blootgestel en opsigtelik en onnatuurlik. Ek verwag 'n skielike gehammer teen die venster, 'n beskuldigende vinger, 'n loeiende sirene. Sitting there looking at me, realizing my hands are shaking. I find the reverse, drive, aware of the subtle woman's smell, her perfume that lingers here inside the car. Warning traffic. Okay, so onthou nou, hy is in Bloemfontein, dis bietjie snaaks dat hy praat van verkeer. I find it a little bit strange that he talks about traffic because we don't really have a lot of it. It is a slow 4 kilometers from the hotel to the Loglaugen shopping center, Bloemfontein's cheekily named waterfront. I keep my hands under the steering wheel to hide the gloves. I stare out before me. I feel exposed, invisible, and unnatural. I expect a sudden knocking on my window, an accusatory finger, a wailing siren. Net enkele voertuie by Loglaugen. Dit is nog te vroeg, maar ek het nie 'n keuse nie. Teen 11:00 verstryk die hotelbespreking. Kom die skoonmakers om die kamer op te ruim, dan moet ek klaar wees. Ek parkeer die RAV tussen 2 ander motors, haal die Robbie de W-serie uit, kry die kassie daarvan in die paneelkissie. Robbie het dit geteken, vir Sasha, in sy sierlike hand. Ek neem dit en klim uit, sluit, druk die sleutels en handskoene in my sak. Dan stap ek terug hotel toe, die son brandend teen my rug. Only a few vehicles at Loglaugen. It's still too early, but I don't have a choice. By 11 o'clock, the hotel reservation expires. The cleaners will come to clean the room. Then I have to be done. I park the RAV between 2 other cars, take out the Robbie de Beer CD, get its case from the glove box. Robbie signed it for Sasha in his graceful hand. I take it and get out, lock, push the keys and gloves into my pocket. Then I walk back to the hotel, the sun burning against my back. Okay, dit is waar ek gaan stop vir vandag. Julle sal sien, ek gaan weer vir julle vraagies op die groep sit wat julle asseblief in julle boeke kan antwoord. So I'll put some questions on the group again for you guys. But yeah, so this is what we'll be doing this week. We're just focusing on the short story. Remember, please, guys, if you want to ask me any questions about anything to do with the work, please do so. Don't worry. I will answer.